the person was on the ball enough, and they said, is that a Modigliani sculpture? And then told their colleague back at the office, oh, I just went to this place that it was a great sculpture. So they had gone for another reason, and then they ended up convincing the family to sell the Modigliani. And they said, I mean, Giacometti had just sold for like $90 million. And so they said, oh, you know, modern sculpture is really popular right now. And so they agreed to sell it, even though they weren't, they didn't need the money. They were billionaires. And they weren't planning to sell. It's just one of these things that happened. So the estimate, the Modigliani's art was undervalued for a very long time. So the estimate was like 5 to 6 million, which I knew was ridiculous, because Brancusi's sculptures had been selling for like $28-30 million. And I thought he's at least on the same level as Brancusi. So in any case, it estimated 5 to 6 million. I logged on to, took place in Paris, I logged on to the auction just as the hammer was coming down at 52 million. So that was the beginning then of this kind of jump in Modigliani prices. That was like 2010 or something. And so, and then his field was going up and up and up and up. So it's interesting to follow all that. Here's another one. This one's at MoMA. It's on the left, and then on the right you have the African mask, and clearly it was based on African art. Then he also made brilliant works on paper. A lot of curated, which is an architectural feature. And what he, so Western architecture. But in these images, he gives them a Cambodian face, the Cambodian or Khmer. So that's why you have a Khmer sculpture in the middle there. And so that inspired some of his curiosities on paper. But they're really, you know, very, very attractive. A museum had just opened in Paris with non-Western art. Clearly he went, clearly he took notes and was inspired. Here you see another painting of a curiosity and a drawing. Now, with Modigliani, there's not always a one-to-one correspondence between his drawings and his art. It's not as if every drawing will have a painting that it's attached to. So in this particular case, it did exist. So so here he's done the same subject in pencil and painting. I love it. I think it's brilliant the way he's pushing on the top of the paper, like it's a weight roof or something. So there are a lot of really clever aspects in this. So a section here on his exhibitions, the Cubist room at the 1912 Salon de Cannes. So you see, and he set this up himself. This is an installation that he set up. So four sculptures on pedestals. So there are records that he would arrange them in his studio in a particular way and make a little temple with them, and in fact had candles on top of the heads of the sculptures. So he conceived of his sculptures as being part of a temple installation. I think the one missing sculpture was in this. This doesn't have all the works featured, but then in the press at the time, they reproduced the works. And so I think that one missing sculpture was in this famous installation. Yes, in fact, there then this was one of his last shows. It took place in London at Heal and Son. So Heal is, was and is, still exists, a department store. I think it was founded in 1810 on Tottenham Court Road. And so at that point they had an art gallery in the store, and they had this exhibition of French art 1914 to 1919. So Modigliani was in that, had a lot of drawings, and other artists were there. Then it ended up closing, and it just reopened in London. So you can visit the Mansart Gallery in Fields today. And they still have exhibitions. And this is the last known photo of him. We're not quite sure what's behind him. I asked a friend of mine who's a specialist in Asian art, and she said that's definitely not a Japanese screen, or a Chinese screen, or a Korean screen, and she had no idea what it was. But in any case. So I wanted to end just by, because a lot of people always want to hear about this, it's fakes in the Modigliani world, in authentication. So that is a problem today, no question. So I'll give you a little history about that. And that's what my committee, I have a committee, a nonprofit group called the Modigliani Project, and we have two meetings a year to evaluate works for collectors. Our next meeting is actually next week. So people submit their works, they pay a fee, we meet in New York at an art shipper, handler, in a viewing room there and evaluate the works. We have a conservator look at the work in advance, and she writes a 50-page report on each object and what she sees, the pigments, the underdrawing, the, you know, whatever she can comment on, she does. There's been a lot of exhibitions and attention given to Modigliani from a technical standpoint. So there was a show at the Tate about 5 years ago, and they commissioned about six conservators to write articles on looking at Modigliani from a technical standpoint. Then there was a similar thing in France, came out last year, a catalog, looking at all the Modiglianis in French public collections. And so they had done a thorough scientific analysis of those. And then the Barnes, they had a show recently, this year, and this year. And their catalog addressed technical aspects as well. So all of that material is very valuable to us. We don't put on our website exactly what they said. I mean, people can read it themselves, although it is very technical. But we get pointers from those articles of things that we want to see. So that's what we look for. We don't put it on our website because we don't want to give people a recipe on how to make them on their own. So, and have them say, you said that titanium bread is in 90% of the paintings, and my painting has that. It's got to be real. I want to see you. So you, in the Modigliani world, you have to be careful what you say and don't say it. So after we evaluate a work, if we think it's right, we put it on our website. So we have an online catalog resume. We never like feature ones that we think are wrong, even though people tell me all the time we should do that. Would be helpful to the field. But you don't want to tell someone they have a fake Modigliani. And it's not worth $30 million, it's worth $50. So so we never do that. And so we just tell people, look on our website, artists will post the ones that are correct. If you don't see your painting, badly. So, but I would never, the most I would ever say to someone is, the committee decided not to include your painting in our online gallery. So that's kind of the same as saying it's not right. But I don't say, your painting is a fake. Have a good day. So it's tricky, the way it's handled. But one has to be careful. And then, of course, a lot of people, if their work doesn't pass, they say, can I have a refund? And it's like, it's not our fault that your painting is fake. No, you can't have a refund. So, as our lawyer likes to say, she says, the fee is the same regardless of the outcome. So if it's right, it's the price. If it's wrong, it's the same price. So because we charge to evaluate works, because I pay my experts, I have to rent a viewing room at this warehouse. A couple of my people will live over in Europe, and I pay for them to come in. I mean, we have expenses. And so it's not our fault if you're
painting. How much do you charge for a painting?
For a painting, it varies by medium. For a painting, we charge $15,000. So for a drawing, it's $7,500. But compare that to, if it's correct, then it's worth $30
million. But if it's fake, it's worth nothing.
Well,
at least you know.
Well, right, that's the thing. Well, then they save the money in terms of insuring it. There's a silver lining there, right?
So, sure.
I've got
Well, that's the thing. You know, I say to you, you can still enjoy it. I mean, it's still a beautiful object, no matter who made it. Regardless of who made it, it's still a beautiful object. So there's that. So we have accepted for our online catalog resume, I would say 35-40% of the works are accepted for our catalog. The rest is silence. Yeah. Hello? No, they're buying them from garage sales or...
So there's no paperwork.
Right. So that's why you have to be careful when you're buying art. You have to know the background, the provenance. I mean, ideally, you would like to know where it's been since it was made. So that's part of what we do, is we do research and we have extensive files. Archives, so we can look up in different catalogs and see if it was in this one exhibition in 1924. We look at the labels on the back, but whatever the documentation they have is obviously very important. So we say, bring whatever you can, give us whatever you can, and that every little thing is important. Every little label on the back, or if it's like even a number 23, then we can compare it and say it's probably number 23 in this exhibition catalog. So there's a lot of sleuth work involved. But having the scientific work done, very important, because often our person will say, there's titanium white in here. And titanium white was invented after Modigliani died. So not long after. But if it has titanium white, not good to use. So, but sometimes she says, you know, we see this pigment, and that's very common in his works in the south of France. Or we see this other pigment, and when he was in Montparnasse, he used that pigment a lot. We'll see the stamp of a an art supply store, and could be one that he was known to use, or across the street from one of his residences, something like that. So that's why every bit of information is helpful. Yeah?
How important is the frame? Do you study that?
Not so much, because generally Modigliani would not have been involved with that. Usually his dealer would have. But yeah, we consider everything. Everything is a bit of evidence. There's a new test that has become available in the last couple of years. It's called canvas weave analysis. And that's where we take a high definition x-ray of the canvas. And canvas, you know, is made on a loom and on a spool. And so it will have some imperfections which are repeated. Like every 10 inches, there'll be a black dot or this or that. So we send this to our guy. He's a retired professor. And he has many of these works he has there, actually infrared, in his computer. And then he could compare that to other canvases and say, this is from the same roll of canvas as this other painting. So, and that has turned up some interesting results. That's almost like a DNA test. And so I worked closely with this one collector in New York, and so hers was the first guinea pig. So I said to her, hope you don't mind, I'm going to send information about your canvas to this guy. So he's west of us. So I sent it to him one night, and the next morning he wrote to me and said, this painting was painted on the same canvas as this one at the Orangerie in Paris. They were definitely both made from the same roll of canvas. And I was not surprised. In fact, I thought that that painting had the same sitter as the one here. Both had red-haired boys. So it didn't surprise me. It didn't surprise me. And, you know, I told the owner, and she was very pleased, because it just validated her painting. We'd already said to her, based on all of our research, we think unanimously that it's a Modigliani. And so this was yet more information for her.
Are you familiar with the recent American Armenian painter, Panagian? His works were found in his home out in Long Island, and there was many exhibits given of his work sent around the country. And I think it's authentic because the person who was, I don't know.
It's coming from his family.
I'm sorry?
It's coming from his family.
No, it's not coming from his family. They were going to sell the property, and somebody found all his paintings in the garage. And then there was an exhibit on a gallery on 57th Street in Manhattan. The person who's curator is sending this around the country to Europe. And I don't know how successful it's been recognized, but you're not familiar with it.
Don't know the name.
They have the Pinagian.
Hello? Yes, yes and no. Here's the thing, is that when someone submits a painting to you and they give you a provenance, it could say on there Sotheby's or Nobler Gallery or whatever, but that doesn't necessarily mean that it passed through their hands. I mean, they could just mention that because they think it'll look good. So, how about so it's a little hard to say because and that's why provenance is helpful, but that alone can't tell you anything because you can't rely on it unless unless they, there are gallery records and they confirmed in their records that they had this painting, Portrait of X, in a certain year, showing that they did own it, that it did pass through their hands.
Yeah, I'm just curious, because this was a high-end gallery, and when they put this salt, who was working in Sotheby's at the time, only a number of pieces that turned out to be fakes. So,
right, well, there was a whole number there a few years ago where this Nodler was selling some works, abstract expressionist works. And in fact, the dealer was listed as a woman from Long Island, actually in this area.
Yeah.
Gloria Lafierez or something. And so she was selling them, and she wasn't revealing where they came from. Or she would say that they got it from a collector in Switzerland who inherited it from his father. And she was very vague about exactly where it came from. And then it turned out that there was a Chinese painter making these in Queens. So, and I think he was involved in uncovering them because he said, how much is my painting selling for? I didn't get that much for it. So, yeah, that whole, yeah, there have been a couple of things on Netflix about the Nodler affair. And it's fascinating. And how they uncover these situations. So yeah, so that not only involved Long Island, but it also involved this town, basically. Right.
Yeah.
Well, the art dealer, she was brought in as being involved. And her, what she said was, well, I myself bought one of these paintings. And the one she bought, actually, the artist's name was misspelled.
Oh,
I think Jackson Pollock was misspelled.
Wow.
So, you know, there was, it was P-O-L-L-A-C-K. And it's like, how could you buy a painting where the artist's name is misspelled? So it just didn't add up. You know, things just weren't adding up.
Thank you.
But yeah, there are a couple of good ones, at least two or three good ones on that point about art fakes. Okay, all right, well, thank you very much.